There must be some way out of here.
Welcome to Humanities Profile. My name is Ethelbert Miller, and my guest today is Mark Raskin. Mark Raskin is the co-founder of the Institute for Policy Study. He's also the author of Visions and Revisions and The Common Good. Welcome to Humanities Profile.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be with you.
Mark, I want to take you back to 1963, and that was a time which you and Dick Barnett decided to start the Institute for Policy Studies. What were some of the reasons?
Well, the reasons came from our own experience in the government, where what I found was that the major problems that we faced were political and moral, but that in the government itself, questions were looked at in terms of administrative and the kind of hierarchic system which made it very hard for younger people to be able to disagree with what the ongoing hierarchic structure was at the time. The other reason was that I had been friends with a great scientist whose name was Leo Szilard. And Szilard took the position that it was important to have in Washington people from the outside who had a certain amount of wisdom and capacity to be outside the government, to be working together, and to develop a criticism of particular policies, and where necessary, to do it in a systemic way. So that was the original notion of the Institute. We also thought not to take government money, which we didn't do, under the theory that if you were in the pockets of the government, you would not be able to tell those truths, so to speak, that you felt were very important.
If you look at that time also, though, that's a time when people say the best and the brightest were here in Washington, D.C., people who were attracted, you know, by the Kennedy administration.
Well, there's a certain amount of truth to that. But on the other hand, one shouldn't overstate it, because people who came into the administration in many cases, not in all cases, but in many cases did have a lot of education. But as soon as they got into government, they took the education clothes off, and they wore the power clothes instead. And during that period of time, as again what we're coming to see, the concern was nuclearism and nuclear war. And that problem was absolutely central to that period of time. And so a very great deal of time and energy was spent on the part of people in other think tanks, and also people who came into the Defense Department, in thinking about contingency plans of how to develop warfighting capacity with nuclear weapons, first strike capacity, first use capacity, and so forth, which I found morally an abomination.
But you were actually on the inside at one time, because you were on the National Security Council.
That's right.
You were working for George Bundy. What caused you to sort of like break from that group?
Well, during that period, there were only eight or nine people who were part of the National Security Council staff. So it was a very small staff. When I came to the White House, I had already written a book with a person whose name is Arthur Wasco. And the book was called The Limits of Defense. And what I did was do what was called a sociology of knowledge, to try to figure out what the deterrent policy was of the United States with regard to nuclear weapons. So I went to the Army and asked them, well, what did they think deterrence was, and what did they think the Air Force's view was, and so forth. We went to each of the different departments. And the conclusion of it was nobody knew what the others was, other views of deterrence were. Furthermore, they said to the extent that they existed, they were wrong. So that already put a question in my mind. The other question, of course, was that deterrence, in fact, is nothing more than a passive threat, which is to say, if you do certain things, then we will respond in ways that we think are going to punish you. And they can be, you may have too many nuclear weapons, you may use them against us first, We may not like your smile. You may not be doing things the way we think you should.
I think it's
do.
Also important to go back and look at this as a time when we're dealing with a missile crisis. I mean,
yes.
This is not just abstract.
No, none of this is abstract. And by the way, none of this is has been abstract over these years. The only difference during that period was that it was palpable, that it was clear. So, for example, if you took the Cuban Missile Crisis as a case in point, one analysis of it, my analysis was that this was a statement of saying that the social contract is over, because any individual leader or several people around him could risk the lives of everybody in the society and everybody else for their own view of whim or interest or purpose. And so that meant that everybody was a hostage, not a citizen. And as you know, even under Hobbes, you're able to run away, but there was no place to hide during that period or now. And so that was a very, very serious thing. The other thing so that meant that we weren't citizens, we were hostages. That, of course, colored my own judgment about what we were and what we thought we were doing. The second thing that had occurred prior to that was the notion of civil defense, that what we needed was having fallout shelters and so forth and so on. And the fallout shelter notion was, from its beginning, just foolish. And
I remember those drills we used to have.
That's right, the drills, which meant absolutely nothing. And people were supposedly going to get credit if they built their own fallout shelters. There are some interesting asides to this, which one might want to notice or think about. The Southern Democrats, the racist Democrats, were very concerned that the fallout shelters might be integrated. And therefore, they were very, very much against. The other notion was, of the studies that we did, was that the reality, the studies that we undertook, was that the reality was that the cockroaches and the rats would inherit the country after a nuclear strike, even if we were to strike first, because the Soviets would hit our cities. They'd made that very clear, that they would destroy American cities. Now, the interesting thing about all of this was that the thought, some people said, well, we've got to do this in order, in quotes, to protect Berlin. But when it came out that this is what it was going to cost, even if you were to have a first strike, the leading members of the White House staff, Ted Sorensen, others, myself actually, not a leading member, but certainly a second order person, said this is absolutely crazy. This is mad. And I'd gone in to see one of the people, Carl Kaysen, who was a very distinguished economist, and who at that time was the deputy to Bundy. And I said, how are we different than the people who measured the boxcars for Hitler to move the Jews into Auschwitz? And in reality, it came to, in my view, the same thing. So there was a series of disenchantments which occurred, and which made clear that I had to be someplace else. Indeed, Dick Barnett and I, while he was in the Department of State and I was in the White House, picketed the White House during the period of the Cuban Missile Crisis. So that's how far off
right.
we were.
Well, let's look at you. You know, Dick Barnett and you, Mark Raskin. You developed this Institute for Policy Study. We know if we look around Washington, D.C. today, there are many think tanks representing the political spectrum. What are the roles of these organizations? How do they function?
Well, at one point, you could make the argument that if there were strong political parties, you might not need think tanks because, as for example, in Europe, there might be, there was at one point, and then people began adopting our notion of think tank, was that political ideas came from the political parties. And so you had those people who were part of brain trusts in relation to political parties. In here in the city, the idea of think tanks really begins, I would say, with the Brookings Institution. And it had a very specific function by the 1930s, which was to attack the New Deal. That's what they undertook to do politically. In the 1940s, they began shifting and became more technocratic and had the support of government by the late 40s or 50s for specific policy alternatives that they would come up with. So they were on contract to the government. In that period of time, the American Enterprise Institute became much more important and as yet didn't take off, but they were there. And they saw their specific road to be that of, in quotes, free enterprise, corporate enterprise. And they received their money from the corporations. So the two, that is the Brookings Institution and the, the free enterprise, saw themselves shaping their ideas in terms of either the corporations or shaping them in terms of specifics, specific ideas on contract from the government.
What happens to, you know, the average citizen? Here you have these groups getting together, sort of shaping policies and stuff. How does that affect us in terms of a democracy?
Well, again, as I'm sure you are aware, as a member of the Board of Trustees of the Institute, the notion was that the Institute would be the Institute for the rest of us, that is, for people who were not connected in that sense, who did not have large sums of money, who indeed raised money week by week and month by month, which we did and have done for some 38, 39 years, which is really an extraordinary feat, I might suggest. But they're out, if you ask me the more general question, that they are not represented through the political parties, because the political parties themselves are now money machines for the largest givers and corporations and so forth, that the ideas which come about are specific ideas for specific purposes through Brookings, through right-wing institutions now, such as the Heritage Foundation, which, by the way, began and had a generation ago and had as a second study, which it did, was to study the Institute for Policy Studies. And they said, well, this is a brilliant operation, but they don't have enough money. A long study. And we will do what they couldn't do because they don't have enough money.
Right.
And part of that related, of course, to the idea that I believe we should have spin-offs, that is, we could set up separate institutional places, separate projects, which would be on their own, which would undertake to raise their own money and so forth. The Heritage Foundation has now, I understand, raised $100 million over the course of this last year and has budgets of $30 million a year, similar to the budget that the Brookings have. Now, there are all sorts of other institutions in the city, very smaller ones, like
Cato.
Well,
I think a key thing would be the relationship of some of these institutes to the government. I mean, I remember, for example, when Reagan came in, it seemed this Heritage Foundation pretty much wrote the agenda.
Well, that's right. And you have essentially that situation now, where the American Enterprise Institute, for example, Vice President Cheney's wife is from the... Lynn Cheney is a fellow of the Institute, the American Enterprise Institute. So that a lot of people come from those institutes, into the government after a while. The problem with these institutes at this point is that they are very narrow in their understanding both of power and politics on the one hand, and of the culture itself, and what moves things in an alternative way. So that they are very much tied, for example, during this period, to the defense budget. Even those who have some critique of it are absolutely enamored of the defense budget and of a national security system. They cannot shake themselves out of it. Some of them, of course, are absolutely, utterly committed to the corporation and to the large corporations. Other states are more libertarian, but then still take the view that government is really no good and that the only purpose of government is for defense and the protection of the free market, etc. So those ideas then come to define this particular time in history. They're the dominant ideas. Now, a generation and a half ago, these were not the dominant ideas. There was a much more liberal understanding.
Let's talk about these ideas and looking at it in terms of young people today, because you hear a number of ideas being spread. Let's look at certain terms, left-wing, right-wing, conservative, liberal. A lot of those terms seem to be really meaningful when we were trying to explain the Cold War in terms of politics. Since then, we hear a lot about being central, being in the middle. If you're growing up today, how should you look at these terms? Do these terms apply to you? Has the world changed in such a way that to say someone's conservative, to say someone's liberal, has a different meaning?
Well, I think first to go back, just for kind of a historical thing for a moment, they come out of the French Revolution, and all it related to at that time was where you sat in the French Assembly. If you sat on the left,
right,
you were on the left. If you were on the right, you were rightist. And so from that came this whole notion, believe it or not, of left-right. Now, in our period, in our time, to be on the left and to be linked also to liberalism, which I view as absolutely critical, is to understand that there is a process in government, process in the society that moves you forward toward freedom and toward inclusivity. So if you look at the period of the last 200 years, you see that it is that the rhythm of this country is an attempt to make good on the ideals that were beneath the Declaration of Independence, beneath the Constitution, but it took and it still takes enormous struggle. So you can read the Constitution as basically a racist, white, property-holding document. That's what the way it starts. But as a result of struggle over this period of time, the last 200 years, its meaning began to change. And that then began to change the effects and the notions within people's hearts and minds as to what this society, what this culture was all about. That, in my view, hasn't changed, and that comes out of a left-liberal view of what the United States, what the American society should be. In that sense, democracy is a project in being. It is not something which is closed. It is not something which is over. It is something which still has to be dealt with, worked through, in terms of the corporations, in terms of democracy inside the corporations, in terms of democratizing other institutions of the society, in terms of protection of individual rights, etc. What we've got now is a situation exactly, an attempt to make it exactly the reverse. And that turns out to be a rightist and to a great extent a conservative position that melds together. So there is a profound distinction which is there. And the notion that Nixon had, which was correct, he said you either govern from the left or the right, you don't govern from the middle, is absolutely correct. And at this point, the Democratic Party attempts to argue we're part of the right center, we're part of that. And for example, Senator Lieberman feels himself comfortable with that point of view. The Blue Dogs in Congress do. The people who were Republican, who were Democratic, racists, and who joined the Republican Party feel comfortable with that point of view. So what I'm suggesting is that there is a divide. Saying that doesn't mean that we can't build a different society or that we can't develop a consensus in the transcendent sense. The only way that can be done is recognition of these differences. And my argument would be that the next generation, the younger generation, has to understand that to bring that in being.
You know, we look at how our society is structured today in terms of the home, the workplace. Many of these places are influenced by the media. And I was wondering, when you look at the media in terms of democracy, how is that shaping our views and values?
Well, as you they recall, in Being and Doing, I call the media the dream colony, which what happens is that, in effect, the media dreams for the person. So it empties the individual out and filling the individual with desires, usually consumer good desires, or stories of which begin with violence and end with violence. And so the other thing that occurs is that the media, and here I'm speaking about television to a great extent, is predicated on individuation. That is to say, there's the individual and the television set. There is no associative relationship between people. It is very hard to develop that out of television. It's also very hard for people really to know what is said on television. They can see what you look like, they can see how you hold your hands, whether or not they can read your face, whether you're honest.
What they're doing right now.
Which is what they're doing right now. And whether or not, you know, they find some sort of simpatico sense with the person. That's not enough in a democracy. And furthermore, where it's the case that the media, the largest media, are owned by fewer and fewer corporations, you know that what is being sold is what those corporations define as, in quotes, the mainstream. So if General Electric owns one of the
networks,
Walt Disney, etc., you know that it's going to be defined in very, very narrow terms. That is the debate.
You know, I want to shift in terms of looking at our institutions, in terms of what has happened over the last few months, moving from the media. Let's talk about terrorism and how it has impacted some of our institutions.
Well, first of all, one has to begin by recognizing that 9/11 was a profound and despicable act on the United States and on American society. This is the reality. This is something which has touched Americans, and correctly so, and has gotten them to realize that they do feel American, and that that there is such a thing as an American culture and American civilization. What that culture and civilization is a continuing struggle. It is not clear what is more important or less important within the society itself. All we know at this point is that there are cultural differences, a pluralism which can, in fact, be reflected. I view that as all to the good. Terrorism itself can be looked at, obviously, in a number of ways. One person's terrorist is another person's guerrilla. One person's terrorist is another person's zealot, crazy. That has to be understood, that behind terrorism are other people who indeed feel that they are being robbed, feel that they have nothing, that they're lost. Now that's for some. In the case of the 9/11 attack, I think it really stems from several things. One is that these people basically, and going back to the 1990 attacks, these people were trained by the United States in their fight, in the American fight against the Soviets in Afghanistan. And there has been what's called a blowback effect on the United States. My concern is that the more the United States pushes itself against terrorism around the world, there will be a blowback effect again, because the United States will undertake to arm various individuals, groups, and nations who are equally as smart as we are.
Let's look before we go overseas. Let's look right closer to home, and the use of the term terrorism, and how we seem reluctant to apply it to certain incidents. I'm thinking of people who, for example, worked in abortion clinics, in which abortion clinics were attacked and bombed. And it seemed that when various people were talking about protecting the clinics and talking about being terrorized, no one wanted to link that term to those activities.
And least of all this Attorney General.
Right, because of his view.
Because of his view about abortion. And so, again, you could make the argument that terror is in the eye of the beholder. But so it is not a useful understanding, in my view. I mean, there are crimes. There are international crimes. There are crimes that states commit. You can call those war. You can call those terrorism. There are crimes that individuals commit, such as the Oklahoma bombing. There are crimes that groups commit.
But doesn't it seem that you look at the list that you just compiled, that it's very important to have a definition of what terrorism is?
Yes, it's a very, very important. It's a critical definition to delimit its meaning. One meaning which is not wrong and which can be included is the specific aiming at, in quotes, innocent populations, which is done for a political purpose or for religious purpose. Now, if you take a look at the United States, well, you could say that there's such a thing as state terrorism, where indeed what we have done, unintentionally in some cases, is to bomb. Yeah, is policy which does, in fact, target innocent populations. The same is true for other states, which have done absolutely the same thing as a result of the kinds of weapons they buy and the kinds of activities they then undertake. So when you use the word terror, it just opens up the question. It doesn't foreclose it. It should get one to look at the symmetries of these issues between the state, between the individual, between the group.
Let me bring this a little closer to home for you, Mark Raskin, founder of the Institute for Policy Study. There was an incident on September 21st, 1976, in which Orlando Letelier was killed right here in Washington, D.C. Many people looked at that as one of the early attacks in terms of action of terrorism here in our country. What has been the Institute's position in terms of keeping that act alive?
Well, there's several things. First of all, this can be viewed as an act of state terrorism, which really I think is what it was. It was organized and undertaken by Pinochet, who at that time was the illegitimate leader who came to power in Chile by a coup. And what he was interested in doing, and what that group was interested in doing, was killing the democratic leaders who had come to power democratically. And so one of the people killed had been a fellow of the Institute, Orlando Letelier, who had been the ambassador to the United States and foreign minister under the Allende government. And my assistant was killed as well, Ronnie Carpen Moffat, in a bomb attack. We have kept the whole issue alive because it is a statement of saying that there has to be individual justice, that there is a set of international laws, there is a set of domestic laws which already exist that do not require vengeance. They do require the use of law and the use of international law and justice, and to bring those culprits to justice. You can indeed, as I would, and some would not, make the argument Pinochet first justice, then look at his age, and then say perhaps mercy. But you cannot say that these people are that they escape because they have state power. That is one of the most important things to come out of the Pinochet case, because it's meant that leaders cannot act with impunity. They cannot undertake war. They cannot undertake the organizing of gangs against other people. Because this has occurred, Henry Kissinger has found himself in trouble because of the sorts of things that he had undertaken with Nixon in the 1969-73 period.
Well, let's look to the future. As we engage in this war against terrorism, it seems as if we really have to look at what's going to happen in terms of international law. If I look at your career in the 1950s, you started out actually studying international law.
Yes, that's right.
And I was wondering, in terms of looking back, in terms of from the 50s up to the present, are there certain things that you're really concerned about that we might change? Also, what is the role of certain organizations like the UN in terms of upholding international
law? Right, there's several things that one should keep in mind. One is that the pushing of an international court of criminal justice, which now some 56 nations have accepted. The United States has not accepted, because they're fearful that both leadership and American soldiers who are abroad could be held accountable for war crimes. The reality of the matter is that that's a far-fetched view, because under the International Criminal Court statute, any case would have to be brought first within your own country. Secondly, a prosecutor would have then prosecutorial discretion to say, no, we're not bringing this case. But it does open up a kind of public relations question for the United States. No, there's no question about that. It should be noted, though, that the United States under Nuremberg pressed very hard for the International Court of War Crimes, the Nuremberg Tribunal, making the argument at that time by saying that this is not only aimed at the Nazi war criminals. We accept this as being aimed at American, at any American leader who does the same thing. We internalize the idea. Well, that was an amazing statement of the prosecutor, Justice Robert Jackson. That hangs there in the middle of the road like an 800-pound elephant, those words. The second thing, when you come to the UN Charter and to the Covenant on Human Rights, is the United States has not signed certain of the covenants and refuses at this point at least to do it. I would view the United Nations, as imperfect as it is, as a very, very important instrument for international law, and it should be supported.
You know, one of the things that we have to look at when we talk about enforcing some of these laws, international laws, is the definition of war. You know, for example, there are many times in which we really haven't legally declared war, so you're sort of like bypassing that. Or we have, as what I see today, a war not against other countries, but sometimes a war against ideas. So you have, for example, like a war against drugs. You know, how do you see these type of things making the use of international law a little complex?
I think it makes it both complicated and very difficult to deal with, which is another way of saying we should be, and this is one of the things that those who are international lawyers, who have a liberal or left bent, should be working on. What is the next stage of international law? For example, over the course of this last 15 years, people said there should be a right to peace that individuals would be able to invoke. Now that's one notion that becomes, I would say, quite important in all this. The other is to say, yes, there are subunits of the states that now operate with some impunity as well. So again, these are international crimes, and ways have to be found together through the United Nations to bring those sorts of actions that these people undertake to task in an international court, an international criminal court. The other point that you make is crucial, and that is that the United States, one would say, is a warrior nation from its beginning. That is to say, fought for its borders, it fought the Mexican War, it fought the Civil War, fought the Indians, it fought the First, Second World War, and so forth. So that in one sense, you could make the argument that the United States is conflict prone, is not afraid of conflict, and views itself as triumphal in those conflicts. Since the Cold War, there's really been war without end through covert activities, through the Vietnam War, through Korean War, and so forth. What's happened now is even more serious, because this administration has made clear that this is a war without end, and that we're not going to stop because we have an enemy other. And indeed, as you point out, the enemy other may exist in a person's mind or may be out there, but you have to keep fighting it.
Right. It's an international fight. Our world is shaped by multinational companies. how does our government in this war against terrorism perhaps try to put certain curtails of the actions of corporations that might want to deal with certain groups for financial interests?
Well, I think you're right. I think that there is somewhat of a contradiction between the international corporation and what the national security state wants to do. No question that you can see this in various places. During the Cold War, there was much more of a linkage between the two. And some argue that during the Clinton period, there was a linkage between the international corporation and what the national security state was supposed to do. To the extent that there's a war without end, for example, the Middle East, and where you have oil companies that want to deal with particular of the groups there, there will be and there is a tension. There's no question about it. Now, whether or not that is more than a tension, I'm not sure. That really depends on who the particular players are at any one particular moment.
Let's look at another relationship that I've been curious about. And this sort of parallels the 1950s, where we saw a relationship between our governments and our universities. As we undertake this war on terrorism, there will definitely be a need for research. There will be a need for, funding certain institutions. Is there ever a concern about the relationship between universities and government?
I think that's a central question. It goes back to the original ideas of the Institute, which started from the assumption that we did not want to be a part of a university, because so many of the universities were engaged with the government in a contract relationship. At the beginning of the Institute, we did have people who came from the universities, and we would go back and lecture at the universities. At this point, you see two things going on. There's no question that the science of the country is tied into the Pentagon through the Star Wars budget. No question about it. We will see the same thing in terms of biological and medical research. Those skew the ideas of independent research. Now, you can make the argument that there is no such thing as independent research at this point. On the other side, it is clear that the national security and scientific research, which goes on and which will deepen in the course of this next 5 years, will be even more serious. No question about that.
Let's talk about privacy and the gathering information. In your book, Abolishing the War System, you make this statement: information held by the few is just another form of monopoly. I wonder, in terms of privacy and the gathering information, once again tied in with this war against terrorism, is there ever that concern?
Again, I think the answer is correct. John Dewey had a very important formulation of this question, which was that democracy means shared intelligence among the people. Intelligence in this sense meaning both rationality and wisdom, but information. To the extent that you have secrecy of the most important issues, such as war, peace, such as the nature of the corporation, and you have that in the hands of the very, very few, you are not operating as a democracy, and you are having a situation of passivity among the people, the citizenry, who are more easily controlled from top to bottom.
I would take the position where there's a difference between intelligence and covert intelligence.
Yes, I would not. Covert, in order to get intelligence, you can get it publicly, from public sources. But why not share that? Unfortunately, a lot of intelligence is gotten through covert activity, which means that it itself is violating some other nation's laws. So if it's the case that intelligence is so important in this society and in other societies, let it be open, let it be shared, and let it be part of the Library of Congress, where it can be used and understood as an instrument for democracy.
I want to ask you another question, which I think is important before we end our show, and that is looking at what's happening to our society, especially in terms of some of the new research and how some of the more ethical, moral questions that were raised about life, cloning, things of that sort. I know you've always thought about the future, and it seems as if we're living during these days of science fiction. What do you feel are some of the concerns we should be monitoring when we look at things like some of the new bio research? What should be our concerns?
I think that, first of all, this is a very difficult question. Secondly, I think that the issue of research has to be linked to research for its own sake. Once it becomes linked to technology, the question is, who does it serve? What is the effect that it has on the rest of the society? What is the effect that it has on few people as against many? Can this research be understood by everybody? Should it be understood by everybody? My argument is that research should be understood by as many people as can understand it. Will the kind of research that's done and the kinds of results of that research cause more and more hierarchy, more and more secrecy in the society? So, for example, if you have nuclear weapons research, this requires greater centralization of power, greater hierarchy, greater secrecy, and greater control. So it has exactly the reverse effect that you want to have in terms of a democracy. If it's the case that you have biotechnology, what is the purpose of this? Is it the purpose here to develop more and more antitoxins, more toxins? What's going on here? And so what we need to do is put all of this research into a philosophic and political context in terms of the good end. That sort of conversation we really haven't had in this society.
I want you to end by looking at this century that we've just started. And what is your hope for?
My hope for this century is that we will have learned something from the past, which is very, very hard to do. And that one of the things we should be able to do from the old century, from my generation in part, not so much yours, but mine, is to teach in such a way that people can make their own mistakes and not to live our mistakes. Let people make their own. What we got now, what we have in our present situation, is that people are going to live the mistakes of the past. They will not be free of the past. It will lay on their shoulders like an 800-pound elephant. My hope through the Institute, through my writings, through the writings of others, through the Paths Project, is to at least help people to the point of saying, this is where we were wrong, this is where we were right, this is what you should think about. These are possible guides for you. Make your own mistakes, but don't live ours.
Thank you, Mark Raskin. Thank you for being my guest on Humanities Profile.
Thank you.
May God bless and keep you always. May your wishes all come true. May you always do for others. Let others do for you. May you build a ladder to the stars and climb on every rung, and may you stay. Surrounding you. stay.